Hey Harvest, my name is Brit Gilman, and I serve as one of the co-campus pastors at the Elgin campus. In the last couple of weeks, two dear members of our church family here in Elgin went home to be with the Lord. And then the other day I heard that now over 100,000 people just from our country have lost their lives due to the coronavirus. And of course, then there here recently was the appalling murder of George Floyd that's revealed that the great need in our country for racial reconciliation. And I say all of that because when you put it all together, it's making me ask, as I'm sure it's making you ask, what can I do? What can our church do? And of course, whether it's the social, the economic, the physical needs of our society, and I know I'm just scratching the surface there. These are loaded issues with many good solutions, and I am thankful for how our church is seeking to respond in a way that is biblical. And so please keep praying for our leaders so that we would continue to be a church that's increasingly shining like a light on a hill. And so our society needs a lot of help, and there are many things that can and must for sure be done. And the good news is that there is one way. There is one thing that you and I can do to be agents of change in our families and our neighborhoods and wherever the Lord would take you. And it's what I'm excited to share with you about today. We are called to be witnesses with Christ. So I want to share with you from a few different passages of Scripture. And the first one's going to be from the book of Matthew. And this is a good passage to start with because it's going to help set up the why. Why are we to be witnesses with Christ? All right, so Matthew chapter 9, starting in verse 37, Jesus is talking to his disciples and he says, "The harvest is plentiful, but the laborers are few. Therefore, pray earnestly to the Lord of the harvest to send out laborers into His harvest." The key word there, you guessed it, harvest. So I grew up in the city. I didn't know a thing about farming until I married Renee almost 25 years ago. See, a fun fact about Renee, she grew up on 800 acres in South Dakota. So she is all things farming, and she's been tutoring me in farming all of our married lives. And some of my favorite stories that Renee has shared are the ones about the harvest season. You see, when it was harvest time, it was all hands on deck. No matter your size, your age, your gender, everyone was needed to go out to bring in the harvest. It was so important. And what Jesus is teaching us here from this passage is that the harvest of souls is plentiful. And it's ready to be brought in. It's important. But the laborers are few. So what's really helpful for us from a passage like this, as disciples of Jesus Christ, we can read this and know now that this is who I am. This is who you are. We are harvesters. I've been, you've been, born again in Christ to reproduce. You and I have a spiritual DNA that's calling us to be harvesters of souls. You see, to not do this would be to not be who we are in Christ. But I'll be the first to admit, unfortunately, that I can hear a word like this and be fired up and have every intention of going after it. But when the rubber meets the road, I have not been really good at living that out. And so I'm asking why. And as I talk with many of you who are wrestling with the same burden, you're sharing with me that you're struggling with the same kinds of things. And so two obstacles I'm finding consistent across the board that are holding us back from being witnesses. Number one is fear. Some of us are afraid of what people might think or say or do if we tell them about Jesus. And the second obstacle is apathy. Certainly without intending or even realizing it, we've just grown apathetic or distracted or busy and neglecting then the opportunity and responsibility to tell others about Jesus. And that's why I'm excited to share with you now a passage that's going to address the issue of how. We talked about why we can be witnesses with Christ, and now how are we witnesses with Christ? And I trust that this passage will help you, like it's helping me, to have a shift, and here's the key, a shift in mindset. And so let me take you to one of my most favorite passages in all of the Bible. It's in Romans chapter 1, verse 16. Paul says, "For I am not ashamed of the gospel, for it is the power of God for salvation for everyone who believes." The gospel is the power of God. I learned something really interesting about that phrase, the power of God. You see, in the original language of this text, the words used there were the same ones used to describe the power of God on display in creation. So you can see why Paul was so confident and courageous to go out to share the gospel. He had the mindset that what he had to share with people was the power of God. And so why do we witness with Christ? It's who we are. And how do we witness with Christ? It's, well, we go out with the gospel, the power of God. Because in the gospel is this power that can set captives free and bind up broken hearts and give sight to the blind and give life to those who are dead in their sin. It's the gospel, the power of God. Well, in the last few months, I've really tried to shift to being a better witness, and I still have a long ways to go. But let me tell you that, you know, God is giving me opportunities to witness here to my neighbor right next door, and to one of the dads on the sidelines at my son's games, and even to my mechanic. I tell you, I'm just about done with my cars breaking down all the time. But if that's what God wants to use to give me a chance to share the gospel with this guy, I'm all for it. Let's go. And so obviously the most important people in those examples I just told you are the ones that I get to witness to. But I want you to know that I think that next to getting married and having babies, that sharing the gospel and being used by God to even lead someone into a relationship with Jesus has got to be one of the high watermarks of life. I want this for you. I want this for our church. And so here are some really practical ways now for you to go out to be a witness with Christ. Number one, starts right here in the heart. Does your heart break for the lost? I asked myself that question a few months ago, and I was pretty disappointed with my answer. And so I've been praying regularly, oh God, would you break my heart for the lost? Would you give me your heart for those who are separated from you? And what if we as a church committed for the next 30 days, starting today even, to praying that God would break our hearts for what breaks his heart, the lost? And here's a real practical idea that could help you exercise that out. Know people's names. Hasn't Pastor Dave Stone been such a great example of the power and the sweetness of knowing people's names? Because when you know the name of, say, your neighbor, not only will that make it easier for you to pray for them, but I believe then that will burden your heart to pray for them too. Well, here's a second way that you can be a witness with Christ. You have a person in your life that you can be witnessing to. Maybe you have so many people that you could be a witness to that you're not sure where to start, and you don't end up witnessing to any of them. Or maybe over time you've gotten so many good Christian brothers and sisters in your life that you can't think of anyone that you could be a witness to. The key is this: ask God, as you're asking him to break your heart for the lost, ask God to give you one life. Just one. God, let's start with one. One person in my life that you, God, would want me to go and be a witness to. All right, here's the third key to being a witness. Be ready to give the reason for the hope that you have in Christ. And one of the most effective and powerful tools to doing that, of course, is your personal testimony. At Harvest, we break that down into three parts. I was, but God, and now. So I wonder, could you share your story of coming to knowing Jesus in, say, 3 to 5 minutes? If you're not sure, take the rest of this month to practice sharing your story, so that whether it's over the phone or over the fence with a neighbor, or one day when we get to go back to work or on the sidelines at a game, you could be ready to share the most powerful story you know, the story of being saved by grace. All right, here's another way that you can share the gospel. In the bottom third right now, you're gonna see a web address for a witnessing tool I found called the Three Circles. It's one of the simplest ways that you can share the gospel with someone. So take some time this week to check out the videos on that website, and you'll find what I and many others have found, that this is one of the clearest and most compelling ways to share the gospel with somebody. All right, let's close with this thought. You may have noticed that as I've been sharing about being a witness, I keep saying that we're to be witnesses with Christ. And for those of you that have been at Harvest for a while, you're probably thinking, Britt, you're saying it wrong. It's witness for Christ. And it's it's not a matter of whether one word's right or wrong. We're just finding that there are many different passages in God's word that are making it clear that when we go out to witness, we do it with the Lord. So one more passage for us. Acts chapter 1, verse 8. Jesus says to his disciples, "But you will receive power when the Holy Spirit has come upon you, and you will be my witnesses." You see, when we go out, we do it with the Holy Spirit. And I hope that brings you comfort and courage and confidence. It's not all on you. You're not out there by yourself. The Holy Spirit's gone ahead of you. He's right beside you. He's coming up behind you. He's with you as you go out to witness. So remember, the harvest is plentiful, and may we be a church that's going out to bring in the harvest of souls. You are loved.